Well, good morning, everybody. I'm Carol Rudge, Head of Not-for-Profit at Grant Thornton, and thanks ever so much for joining our seminar. We were delighted that I think we've got over 80 people joining this morning, so I think we've hit a very topical subject, also delighted that we're able to do this in conjunction with CFG. As I'm sure you all know, otherwise you wouldn't have elected to come to the webinar, the subject is preparing charity financial statements in this new normal. And I think it's probably safe to say that as an auditor myself, my view is that we're probably never going to have such a difficult time in terms of preparing accounts as we're about to go into. I don't think I've ever known so much uncertainty in terms of going concern and then all the other issues that we're all going to be having to think about as we get through to preparing our accounts. So hopefully this session is very timely for everybody. But before we get underway, I just want to outline a few admin points. So first of all, can you type in chat if you can hear me? And I'll just have a look and make sure that we are getting people saying yes. I've got my fingers crossed. I haven't seen any yeses yet. But maybe you're not, you haven't found the button yet to hit chat. Yes, brilliant. Thank you very much for those that have typed in yes. So that's enough now. But if at any point during the webinar you can't hear, apparently if you then refresh the screen, the sound should come back. Hopefully that won't happen, but if it does, that's the solution. So secondly, we'll answer questions at the end, and we are going to keep, I think, 10 minutes back for that. But do type your questions in as we go through, and then I'll read them out and nominate somebody to answer them. That's the perk of being the chair. The speaking facility isn't enabled for anybody other than the speakers, as otherwise it would become impossible with, you know, 80 people on the webinar. That's why we're doing it all through the chat button. Thirdly, the event is actually being recorded, just so you're all aware of that. But as none of you can say anything, that shouldn't be an issue. And then final piece of admin, we will run until 10 a.m. and finish promptly at that point. But before we start, I just want to introduce our three speakers. So first of all, we've got John Tranter, who is a charity FD and probably known to many of you, and he's waving there in the background. He's currently interim FD at CFG, and he will be talking about things from a preparer's perspective. Thank you for whoever kindly moved on the slide there for me. Secondly, we've got Omar Jani, who's head of not-for-profit technical at Grant Thornton. I'm always really pleased to have her online for any technical discussions that we're doing. So thank you, Omar. And thirdly, Stephen Dean, who is an audit director in our not-for-profit team in London. So he'll be covering a lot of the audit side of things. Before I hand over to John, I just wanted to add a few outline thoughts about what we're seeing at the moment in the sector. So really, these are just questions and things that people are asking. So first of all, in terms of management information, given the new ways that most of us are working, have you actually got adequate and timely information to make these big decisions that a lot of people are having to make? Or is everybody so busy dealing with a day-to-day crisis that that information is getting behind? And can you actually get what you need when many teams have been furloughed, and that includes accounts team members and operational team members? In terms of financial position, do you have forecasts that you need under various different sensitivities? Have you considered your going concern position and the impact of coronavirus on your financial statements? And clearly there's going to be a lot more on that later. Have you considered things such as the risk of key supplier failure? Are you on top of your cash on a regular basis? You know, a lot of organisations are making sure they know exactly where they are with cash every day. What government funding are you claiming, and are you comfortable with the decisions that you've made around that? If you need to, have you had discussions with your lenders? So you're thinking about, are you going to breach any of your covenants? And if so, have you got waivers in place? Where you're working with third parties or joint ventures, what's their financial position? Are you going to still be able to deliver in conjunction with them? And if you're looking at cost reduction, are you taking a structured approach to that? Because that's normally the best way. in terms of governance, and I know often it's the finance team that are keeping the audit committee abreast of things. So what should be on their agenda? Are the audit committee meeting regularly enough at the moment? Do you have a back to new normal task force? Because, you know, clearly, hopefully, eventually we're all going to get back to the new normal, and we need to think what that new normal will be. And is there enough active challenge by your board of trustees at the moment, or do you feel that they're rubber stamping? And do you actually need any co-opted members on the board at the moment to broaden skills base to take account of everything that's going on? In terms of internal audit and risk management, how should your internal audit resource be best used over the next 3 to 6 months? Have you considered that all of the new risks that will have arisen, including things such as the increasing risk from home working? It's pretty well established that there's a high likelihood that the risk of fraud will be increased whilst everybody's working from home, because the normal financial controls won't be able to operate in exactly the same way for a lot of organisations. And therefore, do you need internal audit to do a special exercise just to see what's going on, to make sure that everything is as safe and secure as it can be? And then in terms of the future, you know, what does it hold for everybody? Have you started to plan the transition back, and actually what will back look like? What adjustments will be required to your strategy, including people and property? A lot of organisations are starting to completely rethink their property needs. And what can you stop, or perhaps more importantly, what can you not restart? And then finally, in terms of people, are you on top of the mental health issues from both staff and volunteers' perspective? And is your resource planning going forward going to be good enough? So that's just a few things that we have seen charities and all sorts of other organisations thinking about. So we thought we'd just mention those as a sort of a scene setter. And now we'll get into the detail of preparing your financial accounts and then having them audited. So over to you, John.
Well, good morning, everyone. I feel like I'm sitting on a panel of experts, but very much really the sort of audience in the room, I think. I'm John Tranter. I've been in the charity sector, I think, just over 15 years. And I guess just sort of reflecting the journey, which many of you will have had, but perhaps slightly different, but I was looking for a bit of time off just after Christmas, and offered to sort of come in and support CFG a few days a week. And then coronavirus hit. And then I guess, like most of us, it just felt like a bit of free fall, and quite a lot of pressure, I think, in terms of what does this mean? You know, pressure from trustees, pressure from the, if you like, individuals, all looking at the finance person who just arrived for answers. And it wouldn't surprise me, I think, if quite a lot of you feel the same. I think things have sort of settled down in a way in the last few weeks, and hopefully that's true for most people here. And there is a bit more pace to it. There's a bit more of a rhythm. We've answered those initial questions about liquidity. We've probably got something in place around planning the next few weeks, few months. The planning horizon at the start of all this was probably, you know, 2 or 3 weeks. It's moved out a bit now to 2 or 3 months. And I think we're getting to the point where actually we can see a bit further than that now, which is good. In terms of my role here today, as I say, I sort of feel like the audience. I am the audience in the room, and I'm talking not as an expert. I'm talking as a practitioner of a small charity. CFG has £2 million worth of income, 25 posts. Our income comes from membership. Yourselves, it comes from the events we run and partnering and sponsorship. So you can just see from that list that we're likely to have some interesting times ahead. So where we are thinking about our audit, the first thing I think is that coping with the online audit. I think we are fortunate we don't have things like stocks, we don't have banking loans, and we don't have sort of things like pension deficits. But even so, just making sure that we can continue the routines of year end whilst at the same time coping with radically different forecasting procedures and all those sorts of things is quite crucial. And what we're keen to do is at least get the basics done, the schedules done, even if some of the other aspects I'll come on to take a bit longer. Clearly, one of the big issues for every organisation is going to be going concern. And whilst Touchwood, CFG is here for the long term, we are aware that we'll need to be preparing more for our auditors to give them the same sense of confidence that we do. And similarly with the annual report, is going to be a radical change for us. I think it will be, whereas before it's talking about last year with a view on the future, I think for any of us now issuing an annual report that almost isn't set solidly in the new world with reference to the past, but quite a lot about where we are now and where we're going, I think wouldn't be helpful to you as our members, as readers of the accounts, and you'll have the same with your stakeholders. So I think the last piece I think is timetabling. And we're just going through that. We're not going to be running to the same timetable we did last year because of these additional pressures in between. And actually those choices have to be made as to, because actually the here and now, in terms of doing the forecast, managing liquidity, may need to take precedence over hitting that perfect, you know, July sign-off date for your March accounts, which we would all aspire to, if you like. So those are the thoughts that are going through my mind. I think as and when you ask questions, if there's things of a practical thing where clearly I can chip in, I will do. And otherwise, I'm going to be sitting with avid interest and learn from my colleagues on the call. Thank you.
Thanks, John, for that helpful update. So good morning, everybody. I'm going to take you through some of the accounting implications together with Stephen. So before we kick off, I think it's probably worth just setting the scene around the operational challenges that charities are facing at the moment, because many of these will then have knock-on impact on the financial reporting and regularity, the regulatory environment there. So I'll pick up on a couple of the operational challenges and then we'll go a lot deeper and into detail on the issues. So clearly in the current climate, the ability to fundraise is very difficult. I think I read somewhere that a third of a charity's income from fundraising and donations is likely to essentially be wiped away. And then cancellation of events because of the lockdown measures being in place as well. So if we think about the knock-on sort of financial reporting, but other impact as well in this area, it's unlikely, but it is still possible that that donors may request a refund for donations that they have made to the charity, specifically, say, for example, a marathon that's been cancelled. Donation was provided to someone to take part in that marathon. And again, it's looking at, you know, what's the position if those donations have reached the charity. Then you need to think about if those donations have to be refunded and then seeking permission from the relevant charity regulators. This can cause a whole wide range of problems around cancellation of events, particularly where you're using online fundraising platforms as well. So you should really look at what was communicated to the donor at the time of those, when they made those donations. Look at the specific terms and conditions of the contracts with your specific platform providers. So there's quite a lot of guidance out there already from the fundraising regulator as well. And if you do comply with the code of fundraising, you will need to ensure that you are complying with those relevant regulatory standards as well. The other area, clearly, with the lockdown measures in place, and we don't know clearly when these will all be lifted and eased, even though the government has laid out a plan, with the number of charity shops, well, all of them being closed at the moment, the financial reporting impact here that we will come in focus on a little bit later on the webinar, but again, want to highlight here is stock valuation, deterioration of that stock. Do those goods still remain saleable? And then, of course, if you've got property leases and unutilized premises, then clearly you're going to be incurring costs which are unavoidable. However, you're not necessarily getting any future economic benefit from those assets. So there's a number of challenges in place at the moment, just operationally, let alone financial reporting wise. But hopefully we hope to give you some guidance and some practical points as well on how to tackle those. Then this is just a summary of the areas that we propose to go through during this seminar. And then before sort of kicking off on the trustees annual report, I would like to sort of reinforce the point that in this sector, we have a number of year ends. So not everybody's a March year end or a December year end. And so the key question is whether the impact of COVID-19 is in fact an adjusting or a non-adjusting event when it comes to financial reporting. So where we are with this is clearly, if you've got a 31st of March 2019 year end, well, at that time, the impact of COVID was not necessarily clear. It was, it wasn't established. And therefore, the view is that it would be a non-adjusting event for your financial statements. And this view is in line with the FRC and the wider profession as well. When it comes to the early year ends in 2020, so January, February 2020 year ends, a little bit judgmental because whether that's an adjusting or a non-adjusting event requires a bit more analysis. Impact was known, but to what degree was there evidence that conditions existed at the balance sheet date that need to be considered as either adjusting or non-adjusting events? And then coming on to 31st of March 2020 year ends and onwards, it is very clear that the events are adjusting events. The effect of the pandemic needs to be taken into account in measuring the assets and liabilities based on the facts and circumstances at the year end. So throughout all of this, and as new information emerges in the future as well, depending on what your year end is, you need to think about, you know, what were the conditions present at the year end and what new information have you now got subsequent to the year end that possibly could result in either an adjusting or non-adjusting event. So John sort of touched upon some of the points earlier in his update around the trustees annual report. And what Stephen and I are going to do in this part of the webinar is to focus on a couple of areas of the TAR. In particular, the impact of COVID will have a significant impact when it comes to reporting principal risks and uncertainties. So charities will need to be clear on the specific resources, the beneficiaries, the assets that are at risk, and then thinking about what mitigating steps are being taken to protect those assets and resources. Again, when disclosing the principal risks and uncertainties, it's important to make a close link to the numbers in the financial statements, because that's the bit that often people sort of fall down on, the pitfall that you want to avoid there. And then moving on to the financial review. Again, the key message is to ensure consistency between what's being reported in the front end. So that's your narrative reporting, trustees annual report, and ensuring this is consistent with the disclosures in the rest of the financial statements. Of course, significant movements need to be explained, specifically as a result of COVID as well, should be drawn out in the trustees annual report. There are clearly increases increased disclosure requirements for larger charities, and that's explained within the SORP. So for larger charities, it's going to be more sort of focusing on factors that will affect the financial position and performance going forward. So that forward-looking aspect is really important as well. And then fair, balanced, and understandable. This isn't a new requirement, but I think it's fair to say that in the current climate, you know, it's going to be a little bit tempting to, you know, where we can share and tell the good news, we will try to do that. And I think it's about ensuring that it is difficult and there will clearly be areas of underperformance and bad news as well that we have to report on. So it's all about keeping a balanced, a neutral focus so that the users of those accounts can understand how the performance of the charity has been so far, but also how the charity proposes to address any underperformance. And so in terms of those couple of areas, I'm now going to hand it over to Stephen, who's going to take us through the rest of the hexagon when it comes to trustees' annual report.
Thanks, Emma, and good morning, everybody. Yeah, so carrying on around the remaining hexagons in the big hexagon, I'm going to start off by thinking about the reserves reporting. And I suppose that the key thing to note here is that nothing's actually changed in terms of the requirements around reporting on reserves and your reserves policy. But the impact of COVID-19 is likely to have quite a significant impact on what you do actually report and the messaging that comes out of that. So what's quite likely to happen is that charities are going to have to report that their level of reserves is actually not likely to hit the target level that's previously been set. And so it's going to be very important that there's clear explanation within the trustees report that just explains why that's happened, why the charity is still financially viable with a lower level of reserves, and give a bit of an indication as much as possible at this stage as to what the plan is going to be to try and then increase the reserves going forwards. The other part of reserves is also thinking about what things like designated reserves you have and whether there's a need to actually repurpose those. So as you know, designated reserves are those reserves that have been earmarked by the trustees to be used for a specific purpose going forwards, usually in line with something within your strategy. And given the uncertainty and the financial pressures that there are likely to be because of COVID-19, it may be necessary for trustees to think about repurposing or undesignating some of those funds just to help support the ongoing, more basic operations of the charity. So there's a few things to think about there. And the other thing I would also mention is just around the target level of reserves, and just being mindful that this isn't a sort of set in stone figure that must be adhered to year after year. It's something that you do need to, as all the trustees need to be thinking about on an annual basis to make sure that it remains fit for purpose, it fits with the strategy, and there's enough agility in there to deal with unexpected matters like the pandemic that we're facing now. Moving on to governance, I'm sure pretty much all of you will have attended some virtual governance meetings using the various virtual platforms that there are around these days. And whilst that all means that business can sort of carry on as usual, there is the increased risk that the effectiveness of governance might be diminished by not being able to meet face to face, by not having physical papers in place, and also by not having necessarily all the reporting given to you that you might normally expect. So one fairly obvious example is around internal audit. If you have an internal audit function, where the current situation, and particularly the lockdown situation, has meant that internal auditors may not have been able to complete their the cycle of work that they intended to do, what impact is that going to have in terms of you as an organisation, the trustees being able to confirm that they're happy that they've complied with any governance codes that they follow? And then as John helpfully mentioned in his piece, thinking about the future is going to be quite different at the moment. There's obviously a lot of uncertainty because we don't really know where things are going to go over the next few months. But the thing that we can be fairly sure of is that charities' strategies are likely to need to be amended in the short term to deal with the pandemic and make sure that at least the basic operations can continue and the beneficiaries can get the benefits that they need out of the organisation. So just thinking about how that flows through the messaging that goes through the future plans in the trustees report is going to be really important. So then we move on to probably what is one of the most significant topics that comes out of COVID, and that is around going concern. So the slide shows a basic definition of what organisations should be expecting to think about in terms of making that going concern judgment. And as you might expect, under the current climate, the assessment of going concern is going to be a subject that auditors are particularly keen to focus on. That is in addition, of course, to the fact that the Financial Reporting Council were already looking for auditors to increase the amount of scrutiny that they place over going concern judgments and challenging management's assessments. So there's almost a double whammy there, but I think it's actually really helpful that that additional guidance from the FRC is out there and is now being implemented, because it's such an important thing now in terms of supporting you and your trustees in forming that going concern conclusion when preparing the accounts. The bit in bold at the end of that, at the end of the slide there, talking about at least, but not limited to, the 12 months from the date the accounts are approved is important. And actually one of the most important parts of that is the bit that says, but not limited to, because it's really important that you're cognizant of any matters which might fall 2, 3, 4 months post that 12 month minimum period, where there's a significant event which might have an impact on the charity's ability to continue, particularly if there's extra stress put on that because of the pandemic. So things like if you've got loans that are up for renewal and other factors that would affect the operation, it's really important that you make sure you do extend your going concern period of review to beyond just that minimum period of 12 months. And I suppose it's fair to also say that there's likely to be an increased number of material uncertainties in going concern in many organisations. So not just the charity sector, but across all sectors. And so it's really important that the accounts show the thought process around that. There's good disclosure in both the trustees report and the accounting policies, which set out where there might be any uncertainties. Be prepared that there's going to be a lot of charities that might have some sort of modification to the audit report as a result of going concern. It's not going to be as infrequent as it perhaps might have been 12 months ago. So it's just very important that that appropriateness of the going concern basis of accounting is reviewed thoroughly. And as I say, be prepared that there will be a lot of extra scrutiny from the auditors around that over the next, well, at least the next audit cycle, if not the one after as well. So how do we go about considering going concern and making that judgment? Well, the most important one, I suppose, is the first point on the first bullet on the slide there around forecasting and stress testing. And I'm sure you've all got plenty of forecasts that have been put in place, being prepared on a rolling basis. But it's really important now that with COVID-19 that those are revisited. We would also strongly recommend that some form of scenario planning is incorporated into that, and stress testing. And when we talk about stress testing, we actually want to be thinking about the concept of reverse stress testing, which is rather than starting with your scenario and seeing where that leaves you, it's actually thinking about what the worst case outcome might be for your organisation, which to be fair might be that the organisation can't continue. But whatever you assess as to be your worst case outcome, it's then identifying different possible scenarios that you think might lead to that, and just seeing where those get you in terms of those forecasts. And having lots of different scenarios in place means that it's easier then for you to form a judgment around going concern, and it's easier for the auditors then to assess that judgment when they come to do their work. It's also worth bearing in mind that other stakeholders might be using that process already in terms of thinking about forecasting. So for instance, lenders typically use that reverse stress testing approach when they make their own assessments. So having your process aligned with some of your key stakeholders is going to be very important and should make life easier if you do need to get into negotiations with lenders to help support the organisation going forward. I've already talked a little bit about material uncertainties in the second bullet point around the going concern assumption. And as I said, it's really important that the accounts are very clear in describing what those uncertainties are and the nature of them. And as I say, be aware that there might therefore need to be some reference to those in the audit report, whether that's an emphasis of matter or a stronger form of modification if those uncertainties are more severe. And then the other area to think about is loan covenants. Now, the impact of the pandemic on charities' financials could mean that loan covenants are at greater risk of being broken. And therefore, that needs to be taken into account when you're thinking about your going concern assessment. And the sooner you can start thinking about, through those forecasts, whether there's any likelihood of any covenants being breached, the better, because if you can reach that conclusion before your year end, then you have a greater opportunity to liaise with the bank around getting any potential covenant waivers in place, which not only then strengthens your going concern assessment, but it also means that you can avoid having to reclassify any long-term loans to short-term, which clearly makes the accounts show a weaker position. So I think all those factors there are very important as part of your process in terms of forming that judgment around going concern. And clearly these are going to be the areas that the auditors are going to be particularly interested in looking at and scrutinising when they come to do their work. So then moving on to another topic, which we've seen having quite a big impact in accounts, is where you have valuation of property. So clearly this won't affect all organisations, but what we are seeing is that from the professional valuers, where you've got valuations that are being prepared to certainly to 31st of March 2020, they're pretty much all containing material uncertainties around that valuation because of the lack of certainty around the property market, the building industry and so on. So it's really important that you're mindful of both what that caveat says, so to what extent are they giving a material uncertainty, and also is the value actually going to be able to give an opinion as to what the value of your property is likely to be at 31st of March. Now, going beyond 31st of March, now that lockdown is starting to ease, there's the chance that some of these uncertainties will start to disappear from valuation reports as more clarity and certainty gets built back into the property market and valuers are simply allowed to actually move around and visit the properties that they need to value. But bear in mind that if we get a second wave of the pandemic, as has been predicted, and certain lockdown measures have to be implemented, then for future year ends, we may go back into that same regime of material uncertainties dropping into these valuation reports. And the impact of these is really critical in terms of whether the valuer, as I say, is able to give an opinion as to what the value of your properties are. So if they can, but there is just uncertainty because no one just simply knows what the market was saying or doing at that time, then we're probably going to be in emphasis of matter territory as far as an audit opinion goes. And that would mean you'd also need to have disclosures in the fixed asset note around those material uncertainties. But that could extend to a full qualification if the valuer has actually been unable to form an opinion on that valuation. So there's a range there, and it's something that needs to be thought about and the auditors will be discussing with you in terms of the impact that there might be on your accounts. And don't forget also, if you're in a land and buildings revaluation policy regime where you're actually only getting a full valuation every 5 years, and in the intervening years, you need to think about the challenge you're going to get from your auditors for those intervening years where you're just making an assessment over the value of those properties, because it's going to be very hard to actually say for sure whether the value needs to change or stay the same or what it should be. So the examples of where this will apply, the obvious ones are what I've just been talking about in terms of your land and buildings, investment properties. But the other less obvious area that this might affect is if you have a defined benefit pension scheme where part of the asset, part of the assets that represent the part of that scheme actually fall within property assets. It's important to understand there, and that might mean delving back through what the actuary information the actuary is providing to you, whether there's any material uncertainty that's been applied to those property assets within the pension scheme. So a few things to think about, and as I say, a few things that might impact on how the audit report will look. So I think Omar.
Thanks, Stephen. So I'm going to take you through impairment. I think one of the key things to remember here is that impairment is one area of significant judgment, and what the accounting standards require, both under the SORP and FRS 102, is for the charity's trustees at each reporting date to consider whether there's any indicators of impairment. So when it comes to the asset, so are there any indicators of an asset being impaired, and if there are, then an impairment review needs to be carried out. The impairment loss would need to be recognised essentially when the carrying value of the asset is more than its recoverable amount, and again, both FRS 102 and SORP define the recoverable amount as being the higher of the fair value less cost to sell and value in use. I know it's a lot of terminology and things that I am throwing that out there, but I will go into a bit more specifics in a moment. And then specifically when you are looking at the value in use calculation and the recoverable amount there, it's important that this is determined using the cash generating unit to which that asset belongs. If it doesn't, if it cannot be determined that that those cash flows generate from an individual asset. So there is a lot of guidance in the SORP. I think the key question, the starting position is looking at the balance sheet date, thinking about, do you have any indicators of impairment? If so, what are those indicators? And then thinking about, well, now I'm going to have to do an impairment review. And so then I should therefore look at, you know, what's my recoverable amount? The accounting standards doesn't require you to go and calculate fair value as well as value in use. So it's one of those where you need to decide. Again, when we're thinking about value in use, which is probably the one that's more likely to be used in this sector, for charities, it's not always about cash generation, as we know. So an asset may be held because of its service potential, the service potential for the charity's beneficiaries. So in that case, actually, when looking at and calculating the recoverable amount, it may be appropriate to use value in use service potential. So that's something to bear in mind. I think just taking that step back, as I said, looking at the indicators of impairment that may be present at the balance sheet date, both FRS 102, so that's within Section 27, and then Section 12 of the SORP provide a list. It's not an exhaustive list. It's just some areas and examples where indicators of impairment may be there. I mean, there's some clear ones where there's been a significant decline in the market value of the asset, for example, or there's evidence that the expected cash flows or the results from the use of an asset are actually worse than what you had anticipated. If an asset becomes idle, or if there are plans in place to dispose of that asset earlier than you would have expected, then again, that's an indicator of impairment. And then there's sort of wider, you know, market factors, if you like. So if there's significant changes in the economic environment, which clearly that's where we are at the moment, possibly the legal environment as well. If those things adversely affect the charity's activities, then again, that is going to be an indicator of impairment. For charities more specifically, I think it's fair to say the impairment assessment is more complex than perhaps a commercial organisation, because you're there providing vital services, so there's a demand for services. But if that demand significantly decreases or ceases because you're not able to provide the service, then the assets used to provide those services may be impaired. Again, looking at sort of major environmental demographic factors, so for example, the number of charities, your beneficiaries who you're able to provide a service to, or the nature of those services or the needs of the charity's beneficiaries change. Again, that could prove to be an indicator of impairment. It will come down to the specific facts and circumstances and the activities that your charity carries out. But I think it is an area that is complex. It's something that you should plan for early on. Particularly, this is an area that auditors will be looking at in a lot more detail as well, and challenging management around what their assessment is around impairment as well. On the next slide, what we've got there is just some examples of assets which may be impaired, so where the asset value may be declined. So typically for you, it's important to think about those tangible fixed assets. As I mentioned, the services that you're able to provide may have significantly declined in this current climate due to sort of lockdown measures. There'll be unutilized assets as well. So I think that slide is just to sort of keep there to help you think about these sort of assets that may need further consideration. Okay, so then other areas as well, which we haven't touched upon. I am conscious of time as well, so I have cut down on the impairment, and we do want to cover off the next section as well. So I'm going to hand it back to Stephen, please.
Thanks, Emma. Yeah, so I'll just run through these fairly quickly so that we can get through the rest of the presentation and give you time to have some of your questions answered. So the first one, just on grant income, is really thinking around, are there any changes that have taken effect from the pandemic on the entitlement to recognise grant income? So that might be where there are conditions that that cannot now be fulfilled that the funder set on that grant, and also where you're expecting a multi-year grant, so you had future commitments given to you by the funder. Have the circumstances of the funder changed such that it's now going to be impossible for them to pay you the remaining instalments? So a few things to think about there, just in terms of impact from the climate. In terms of legacy income recognition, a couple of things there. The first one is around, has the timing of recognition, is that going to be affected because it's now taking longer to process legacies as a result of the challenges being faced from COVID-19? And the other aspect to it is that quite often the legacy may include assets, so for instance a house or some other property. Given what we were talking about just earlier in terms of valuations, is it going to be difficult for a value to be ascribed to that legacy, and therefore does that mean that the recognition criteria are not met at that point? For some charities, they receive donated goods, particularly a good example of that might be for where they have charity shops, so they might receive donated goods for resale. And typically those would be valued and recognised as stock in the accounts. One thing to think about there is, has the impact of events like lockdown, has that meant that the certain items that have been donated to you now need to be impaired? So for instance, were you given anything that's perishable? Were you given anything which was very specific, such as, I don't know, relevant to the VE Day celebrations recently? Are those things now not going to be worth as much as they would have been, and therefore do you need to think about impairing them? So something to think about for stock that you're still carrying at year end. Clearly anything that was donated and has been sold, you know what that was sold for, so there's no issue there around that impairment. And then just on the opposite side, so obviously we're just talking safer areas here. So on the expenditure side, where you're a grant maker yourselves, thinking about sort of the flip side to the first point I was talking around with income. Have you made future grant commitments? Are you still able to fulfill those? Has actually the funder that you're the body that you're funding, are they actually able to still carry out the project that you were funding in the first place, or have their circumstances changed, which means that actually that grant is effectively void and should not be paid to them? The key things around all of this, really, from a grant maker's perspective, are what's in your funding agreement, what conditions are there in there, what do you have control over, and all those things are going to be what drives the accounting treatment in your financial statements. So the next topic is around trading subsidiaries. Many charities have trading subsidiaries, and the expectation is that they should be able to operate on a standalone basis. But clearly, with the challenges faced by caused by the pandemic, there might be some financial difficulties that these trading subsidiaries get into. And so it's very important that charities and trustees are mindful of the restrictions that are in place over providing support to trading subsidiaries. It's not the same case as a commercial entity being able to loan funds to its subsidiaries to prop them up, or provide guarantees over their ability to continue into the future. It's much more restricted for charities under charity law and expectation of the Charity Commission, etc. So it's not going to be possible for a charity to simply prop up its trading subsidiary. A lot more work will need to go into that. You might need to take some legal advice around what you can and can't do, just to make sure you don't fall foul of charity law requirements, or indeed any tax legislation requirements, because anything that you give that's non-charitable can become taxable within the charity. And linked to trading subsidiaries, those of you who have trading subsidiaries, I'm pretty sure will in most cases be seeking to gift aid any profits that are made in year up to the parent. Now, nothing's changed there. You can still do that. But the key things you need to think about are really from a stepping back from a business planning perspective for the subsidiary. Although it might have to pay tax on any profits, would it actually be better off retaining those profits within the business in the short term because of any financial pressures it's under, rather than making the payment up to the parent? It's also thinking about cash flow. I mean, that although it's a reserve movement effectively, you do have to physically move the cash from your trading subsidiary to its parent. So will the company be able to continue to pay its debts as they fall due if you make that cash flow movement from one entity to another? But having said all that, you might actually find that you have little choice in whether you can make that gift aid payment or not, because it all depends on what mechanism you have in place to ensure that there is that legal obligation to make the gift aid payment. So what we're seeing now with the relatively recent change in the way gift aid should be accounted for is that a lot of charitable groups have a deed of covenant arrangement in place between the subsidiary and the parent, and that might actually mean that you have no choice but to pay the gift aid up regardless of the impact it has on the subsidiary, within the bounds of what would be legally permissible with your distributable reserves there. So if you're in that situation and you feel that you have little choice but to make the payment because of your deed of covenant, but you feel it would be detrimental to the operation of that trading subsidiary, then probably the best thing to do is to seek some legal advice around what you can and can't do within the bounds of what your deed of covenant says. So there's a few things to think about there, and it's not necessarily entirely straightforward, but I think very important matters in terms of the operation of your group and making sure you don't fall foul to any legal requirements. Omar.
Hello, I don't think you could hear me there. Sorry, just very conscious of time now. What we will be doing after this webinar is following up with everybody on the call with a in-depth analysis pack, which covers the factors that you need to think about and covers all the topics that we've looked at in this webinar as well, but in a lot more detail. So government assistance is one of the areas which clearly there's a number of schemes and support in place at the moment, possibly not enough for this sector. However, I'm not proposing to go through everything on the hexagon then, because it will be included in the in-depth pack that we do send after this call. But the main one really that's been a hot topic at the moment, and we've had questions around, is the coronavirus job retention scheme. And so clearly this is a government support that charities may be eligible. So this is the furloughing scheme. And there may be a compelling reason, you know, why a charity has had to go down that route. They are eligible, depending on what type of charity it is. The aim here is to reimburse the staff costs being incurred. However, when it comes to accounting standards, it is a government grant. And so the accounting needs to show the government income, the government grant income, as gross, and it should not be netted off against the related staff expense. So that's something to bear in mind as well. And then the other sorts of schemes that are in place. So gift aid claims, this is where a charity has, for example, cancelled an event and a person may be due a refund, but actually they decide to donate that money to the charity. The charity could accept that donation and also be able to retain a gift aid element. Clearly, you know, there needs to be communication from the donor that they're willing to do that and donate the cost of their ticket, for example, for an event. And gift aid declarations need to be completed. But it's something, again, to be aware of. VAT deferral as well. Again, I just want to mention UK VAT registered charities. So there has been a deferral for the period from March to 30th of June to defer the payment until end of March next year. Government said that no interest or penalties will be charged on this deferral, but the VAT return still needs to be filed. But when it comes to the balance sheet, the liability will need to still remain, albeit it's been deferred. So it may become a non-current liability rather than current. But like I said, we will be providing more details on some of the other schemes as well. And then pension considerations. So again, Stephen covered this off earlier on, but I just want to reinforce the fact that it's important to have early engagement with the actuaries in obtaining your pension valuation reports. Particularly, a number of reports will contain estimated asset valuations. And if we think about it, any estimate is likely to increase the likelihood of an error. Particularly in this climate, there's likely to be a significant misstatement if we're basing the pension valuation on estimated asset valuations. So important to get actual asset valuations as possible. So that doesn't become too much of an issue. And then essentially, we're just summarizing here, you know, a couple of points that we've already picked up. And the one that I want to highlight there is reporting to the regulator, where as auditors, we would be required to report to the Charity Commission and the other relevant regulators should there be a modified audit opinion. So I think that brings us onto questions.
Lovely, thank you all very much. So we've got time for just a couple of questions. So the first one, and I'll read it out, is please could you run through the main considerations in terms of adjusting post balance sheet events? And I think Omer, that's could be one for you.
Yeah, thanks, Carol. So I think it is a good question, because clearly it's an area that's sometimes difficult to get your head around. But essentially, events that happen after the balance sheet date, up until the date of essentially authorising and approving the financial statements, that specific time is when you're looking at whether those events provide evidence of conditions that would have existed at your balance sheet date. And if they do provide evidence of conditions that would have existed, then they would be adjusting events. On the contrary, if they're indicative of just events that are, you know, happened after the balance sheet date, then they would be non-adjusting. I think the area that this is going to most likely impact charities is, of course, things like asset valuations. There may be indications to show the asset is significantly declined after the balance sheet date. But actually, you need to then think about, did those conditions, those same conditions then exist at the balance sheet date? And if they did, then that would be an adjusting event. Grant commitments as well. Think about what you've communicated at the reporting date when you are making, you know, where you're the grant maker as well. So just because you've communicated something after the and agreed something after the year end date, it may not necessarily be non-adjusting. So if you've decided not to then make that grant, but actually you already communicated before the year end, you need to really specifically consider what information management had that at that time. So it comes down to facts and circumstances. There are various examples that I could give, but I think the key message is look at what conditions would have existed at the balance sheet date.
Lovely, thank you, Emma. And then another one, which says, what advice would you give to major givers of restricted donations as to the safety of the unused funds should the charity have a shortage of free reserves? And I think both John and Stephen had something they wanted to add on that one. I don't know who wants to kick off first.
Well, if I kick off just from a sort of technical perspective, and then John, maybe if you want to add in anything on top of that. So what I would just say very quickly on that is really the safety that charity law gives over restricted funds. So it's not possible for restricted funds that have not been to not be used for the purpose they were given. The only way you can do that is to either obtain permission from the original donor or to seek permission from the Charity Commission, which can be quite a convoluted process. So to that extent, there should be a great deal of safety for any donors of restricted funds because the law protects them. And if a charity decides to use those funds for a different purpose, then one would hope that the auditors would identify that and would raise that as a challenge to be addressed. Do you want to add anything to that, John?
No, I think it's I think that's it's an interesting question almost from a what I'd call commercial, but I mean a practical point of view. I think a major donor and a charity ought to have a really good working relationship, and communication I think is absolutely key. I think from if you're a donor in that situation and you are worried about the charity, I think it's worth considering. Is the charity's sustaining the charity's overall purpose actually better than perhaps the project you were funding initially? And whether, in fact, you're in a position to be able to lift some of those restrictions to enable the charity to continue. That may not be possible. You may be a charity in your own right, and clearly you can only spend your money in certain ways. I think the other thing, just on reserves, I think there's also a question around, especially if pension schemes are really tightening, if you like, those net asset figures that you see in the balance sheet, threatening them almost to go negative, as to does that cause a sort of paralysis around being able to spend general reserves? And again, I think that's a question really for really good conversations to have with the pension scheme trustees, because ultimately, if you reduce your charity's activities to the extent that you can't almost fundraise for them because you're paying off your pension deficit, then you almost end up in this sort of virtual downward spiral of not having enough income to pay off a long-term pension debt. And that's where this whole thing around being able to meet your liabilities as they become due, the critical thing for your pension scheme is your recovery plan, the valuation for FRS. Yeah, sorry, whichever standard it is these days.
What
it is, thank you. just went then. Is almost, that's a technical issue. The critical thing is the cash flow to the sustainability of the cash flow to the pension scheme. And I think the other thing I'd just also say is impairment and these uncertainties around liquidity is actually, if there is an emphasis of matter in the audit report, I'm not sure that's necessarily a bad thing at the moment. You know, how many organisations, you know, I think it's almost a way of saying, actually, yes, we're in, this situation is causing these uncertainties and we need your support. Mm-hmm. we're not going to be, no charity is going to be immune from this situation. It's not a question of bad management as it might have been 12 months ago. So I think, you know, think about it in those terms. I think where I think it would be a justifiable criticism is if you do have an emphasis of matter, and then your annual report talks about all the wonderful impact you're having and it's all super rosy in the garden. And I think if you've got a disconnect there, I think that would be a challenge, I think. So I think that's all from me.
Thank you. And I think that's going to be all from everyone because we've reached 10 o'clock. So I just want to say thank you again to all of our speakers and thank you, everybody, for listening. And Richard, a particular thank you to you for your nice feedback in the chat. So thank you for that. And as Oma said, we will be sharing our little booklet on financial reporting in the current times. So hopefully that will reinforce the things that we've talked about this morning and answer any further questions that you might have. So thank you all very much. Thank you. And goodbye, everybody.